This is an automatic steam-powered threshing machine. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution.
So what exactly is a threshing machine anyway? Well, grain harvest has quite a few steps. Let's just stick with wheat here, but most grains go through a pretty similar process. Once the grain is ripe, and hopefully at least partially dried, it's cut. This was done by hand for thousands of years, and it was a slow, laborious process with the farmers walking, often bent over in the field for hours a day. Once cut, it would be stacked in small piles, called shocks, with the grain up, waiting on threshing. Fields would be full of countless shocks of grain. In 1934, McCormick invented the first reaping machine. Reaping is just another name for harvesting, as in you reap what you sow. Geared to the wheels, you have paddles to pull the wheat into the machine and a pair of saw blades with one moving back and forth, cutting the wheat like scissors. It's then moved out to the side to lay on a row in the field. You can then gather it up into shocks awaiting threshing. None of this, up to this point at least, is actually threshing. This is just getting ready for threshing. Now you have a lot of wheat on stalks, still in the husks, and you need to get the seed out. Threshing is basically just the process of beating the wheat enough to knock the seeds out of it. You place it on a hard floor or the hard ground outside the barn and beat it with sticks, walk your horse over it repeatedly, or whatever you can to knock the seeds loose. Now I've got a pile of wheat stalks, which is called straw, as well as the wheat seeds themselves and chaff laying on the ground. The seeds are heavy and sink to the bottom. You can carefully rake the straw off the top and get it out of the way, and you'll use that for animal bedding or maybe insulation. And then you sweep up whatever's left. Now to separate all of this, you use a process called winnowing. Here you see winnowing actually combined with threshing, with the heavy seeds falling to the ground and the wind blowing the chaff away, and then the handful of straw is discarded at the end. This works fine for small amounts, you know, what you're making for a family for dinner that day, but it's not really good for a large scale. In larger scale operations like this one, the winnowing was done after the thrashing and the separation of the main stalks. By, again, using wind and dropping or tossing everything up in the air, the wheat seed, again, the part that you actually want, the part we eat, would fall to the ground and the chaff would blow away. Do this repeatedly and you have a fairly clean pile of wheat seed at the bottom. Now this is where powered thrashing machines come in. While they don't do the initial cutting part, they do combine the thrashing and the winnowing into a single machine. These machines, like the reaping machine, were invented in the middle of the 19th century and they were a huge game changer. Farmers would still cut their wheat by hand, typically, or maybe with a reaping machine, gather it together into shocks in the field, go collect it with a horse-drawn cart, move it all into one place. But now somebody would come onto the farm with a traction engine towing a powered threshing machine. In an amazingly short period of time, you'd be able to quickly feed all of this wheat into the threshing machine, and you were left with one or more wagon loads full of good, clean wheat and a huge pile of straw. Instead of spending days or weeks doing the threshing for your field and winnowing everything to get good usable wheat, instead you might spend an hour or two. You can now plant much more acreage and still complete your harvest and thresh everything before you lost your crop for winter, hugely increasing profits. So everything inside of these machines is going very, very fast. And when these were in regular use, there were a lot of injuries and even deaths from them. So everything for safety is very enclosed, and you'll probably never see one of these things running and open at the same time. But the way they work is pretty much the same thing that we were doing manually. You take the cut wheat and feed it into one end of the machine. It loads onto a belt, which pulls it along through the process. Once it gets inside, it's beaten by a series of paddles. Usually the paddles are somewhat padded with some rubber or something, and that knocks the seeds loose. Seeds are still typically enclosed in the husks at this point, but the husks have probably broken off. The belt continues on its way and takes the remaining stalks, or the straw, out the back of the machine and gives you a big pile of straw. The seeds, on the other hand, along with husks, little bits of straw, whatever, fall through the first mesh onto a lower mesh below it. This feeds up to a large fan. The fan blows at high speed and blows all of the chaff away. That leaves you with just the seed that you want. That seed continues out, feeds into an auger, and the auger will then carry it up and drop it into your wagon. There are plenty of thresher designs, but they basically all did exactly the same thing. On this video, I've been showing you two different models, one from the Hesston Steam Museum in Indiana, the other one from the Essex Steam and Gas Engine Museum in Ontario, and they both operate the same way. And that's really true of any of these portable steam-powered threshing machines. Threshers like these were how most grain was processed until around World War II, when combine harvesters, often just called combines, became more common. These moved the entire process into the field, combining the cutting, threshing, and winnowing all into a single pass, powered by a single tractor for the combine. A truck would drive alongside and would receive the grain as it was processed by the combine. This system is very fast, and although this one seems to be really big, it's actually a fairly modest size. They do come much larger than this today.
So equipment like this showed up on farms all over the world, towed farm to farm by traction engines, like this one back here, which is one of the world's largest traction engines, also here at the Hesston Steam Museum. But machines like this would do anything from thrashing your grain to a sawmill, and lots of other things along the way. And that really brought the Industrial Revolution, not just to big factories, but to local farms. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Hey, before you go, I do need your help to keep this channel growing. Easiest thing you can do is just like or subscribe to the video. That tells YouTube, hey, this channel is worth watching. It'll show it to more people. Other thing you can do, completely free, is just leave a comment. More than two or three words is all it takes, and that counts as YouTube interaction. That's the strongest signal you can send to YouTube to recommend a channel to other people. Beyond that, if you can help out, this channel is actually fairly expensive to run. I usually drive 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours each way to get to these sites, so it can get pretty expensive. If you can help out with that, I have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. There's monthly memberships over there. Or if you're interested in just a one-time contribution to help out, just hit the super thanks button on this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you at the next one.